So good evening, everyone, and welcome to the kickoff winter lecture of the Ryerson Department of Architectural Science Lecture Series. We're thrilled to be presenting with the generous assistance of the Dutch consulate, Natalie de Vries, the DV of MVRDV. Natalie, with her partners Winnie Maas and Jacob van Ries, established MVRDV in 1993 in Rotterdam. They've gone on to develop a firm acclaimed internationally for its witty and irreverent buildings, urban designs and landscapes that challenge conventions of type, use, and planning. Their design and research work is characterized for its advocacy of ecology, urbanity, and social vibrancy through density, the provision and design of public space, and their attention to the experience of users. Their recently published book, MVRDV Buildings, documenting the last 20 years of their practice, is entirely composed of their users' images of their buildings shown in use. Imagine promotional material showing real people in amateur photographs of buildings completed in some cases more than 15 years ago. In this focused research and design, attention paid to the life and infrastructure of urban spaces and buildings that brought us to invite Natalie to show us their work and also to take a look at the burgeoning core of Toronto. Her talk this evening will present high-density housing work that they have done internationally, as well as some recently completed civic projects. Natalie is a graduate of Delft University of Technology, where she's also taught. She currently lectures at the Berlage Institute and the Kunstakademie in Dusseldorf. Please welcome Natalie de Vries. And following her lecture, we have a panel discussion that will last an hour, so please stay.
I think I first came to Toronto, a little less than 10 years ago. It's a bit later than 2001, of course, but I was still here early enough to witness, of course, when I came here again 2 years ago, something had changed in Toronto. And I've been corresponding with both Ryerson, with Cheryl, and with the Dutch consulate. That was also so nice to help me with this visit here. A little bit about what's going on here, and I was warned about all the debate and things going on here in the city, relating, of course, to amongst others, what we can see here. So I presume that they will also be part of the panel discussion later on this evening. Actually, I know about that for sure. And it also led to the way I thought I should structure my lecture tonight. As most of you probably know, our office has a quite diverse output, and it ranges really from large-scale urban planning to small interior objects. If the lecture is called, and it's of course not only made by three partners, but by lots and lots of people, of whom you see a small group here. We've been growing and growing lately, so that's maybe even an opportunity for those of you who managed to get a working visa permit in the Netherlands. Right, I could use this one indeed. The lecture was titled Vertical Urbanism. I'm not quite sure where that came from us, from you, from everybody. Somehow, in some kind of email cloud, this title erupted. But I'm not going to give a lecture on urbanism per se. I am going to show mostly how interaction between urban planning, urbanism, and building influences the way we work and the way we think. And like I said, being warned about the discussions, about all the buildings you are making here, all the condos you are, all the multiples you are building, I took the liberty to start off with quite some housing projects that we did, which is actually also part of the beginning of our office. We started in a period in which the Netherlands wanted to build a lot of houses, and it really kick-started also the thinking of our office about dealing with density. But there's more parts. I'm also going to talk a little bit about transformation, which has become much more important in our office as well, as we move back into the cities. And the usage is changing. Transformation is becoming more important. And also a serious task for all serious architects, I would say. A third group of projects I'm going to show are public buildings and the way we deal there with interaction between the in and the outside. And last but not least, again, also connecting to the debates you have in the city, how private clients, private buildings, can still help to activate public space and public life in our cities. So it's all the time about interaction, about how the building becomes urbanistic, and about how urban designs create buildings. Okay, I'm starting with housing. And density is something very fascinating that you could also use and show in architecture itself. This is one of the very first projects of our office, where we were asked to build a slab building of housing for elderly. And with a north-south orientation, that's quite difficult, of course. And we realized there was a height limit, that we missed space for a couple of houses. We didn't want to put them on the site. We were already filling a post-war area with a block where there was previously green. And then we decided to just hang them on the other side of the gallery, of the gallery, and thus creating a new situation that was, especially for the elderly, actually quite exciting, an exciting thought. To live in. Of course, this meant something for the structure of the building. Luckily, the whole structure itself was a bit over-dimensioned because of the thickness of walls being more related to sound insulation than to the actual bearing loads. So actually, walls between houses were heavy enough to carry this stuff as well, cantilevering it. We just had to add another two columns here, and then the rest, a little bit of steel and wood to make sure it wouldn't be too heavy. And the real courageous ones also stepped out on the balconies. And of course the windows kind of following the pattern of where you didn't have structure. And this is affordable housing, so it's, you know, it's really below subsidy borders. So actually, all the ingredients of our work immediately were present in this project. We had to deal with data, we had to deal with decisions about densification. We had to find pragmatic solution to make it buildable and payable. And also the community there, neighborhoods in Amsterdam, said, wow, that's great. Nobody makes ever a big effort in our neighborhood. That's cool. So they didn't object to their green space being built on, but they actually were proud of that such a building would appear in their part of town. From maybe also a bit overcourageous, youthful, we were all in the end of our 20s when we started to do these things. Enthusiasm, it really emerged into a common practice for our office and a common strategy. Another complicated area, another building, a couple of years later, replacing existing high rises by a new building, And in this case, it's also showing how we talk then with our clients and with the municipality about the strategies that we use. Replacing three slabs with a new program that would actually fill a void, blocking view to a park. And then we realize, well, maybe we shouldn't put these buildings next to each other and form a kind of wall, but maybe we can squeeze it together somehow a little bit and put it more in the park. It's on the edge of a park. Here you can see that. And when we connect the top and the bottom, we can even produce more houses and create a couple of big urban living rooms inside the building that can also act as for the architecture aficionados who like the Netherlands. This is from Aldo van Eyck, a famous playground he made, a series of playgrounds in Amsterdam in the 50s and in the 60s. We could make a couple of living rooms inside the block, also a bit lifted from the big park, offering a kind of, more safer, guided environment between the different towers connected at the top. A lot of people will have views to at least two sides in this building. Here, the materialization is a bit more sophisticated because the group of people living here are one financial level up from the previous building. So a bit more, little bit more money to spend. Still, Affordable Housing Corporation was allowed to build this. Glazed bricks that have this pattern, look a bit like wallpaper, of course, to furnish and finish the furniture. A friend that, I don't know if you can see that, designed a beautiful chandelier hanging in this living room. And everything slightly oversized flower pots and carpets and, all the ingredients you need for your living room. And of course, an idea about living in this building, creating some meeting spaces, areas for small children to play, and to have events with your neighbors inside. But Dutch density is, of course, kind of easy baby density, like easy to solve issues. It has been in the past. Our office was really put to the test in some other continents, on some other continents, especially in Asia, when trying to bring our friendly humanistic architecture to the next level. So when we were asked to make a neighborhood in China, in Tianjin, with a Dutch flavor, meaning bricks, we actually started to think about all these solo towers that are built there on their islands of tiny parks, sometimes gated, and this sort of urbanism that actually in the Netherlands we were replacing by other types of building, being built here again and in vaster amounts and taller and higher. Also breaking down neighborhoods. So this is on this plot here to the right, where we were supposed to build. You see the original fabric in black. And we actually suggested to make a new fabric, but still based on older grids. And then, of course, the reality of a city like Tianjin, that it's growing, exploding. We definitely had to make a lot of housing. So starting from this pattern that derived from the original street pattern, also with the ideal orientations, we started to add volume to it, which is the second step, a bit hard to read, of low-rise housing, then put in towers in the favorable direction of Chinese housing. They, of course, casting a shadow where we would remove the low-rise housing, which is the red square. but that's by accident. And then placing enough towers to be able to fulfill the programmatic requirements. and then assuming it could start to look like this. Now, extreme differences. So we kept the low, we kept low rise because with the low rise we could actually make street patterns and single family houses, row houses, using patio typology. We will see that more often, which is outdoor spaces that can work quite well in dense situations. Making buildings for commercial purposes in offices on the outer fringes, where the really big 12 lane probably streets are, and all with a good view to the river also in the nearby side. Oh, here you see that. So we twist and turn the page a little bit again, and so happened. So there it is. It's one of the projects we also revisited and checked in on again after I think it was built almost 10 years ago. Our first realization also in China. So these were the first drawings. We always try to make a lot of photographs before, after of our projects, where you can still see most of the original ways of usage. And also the effect of where the low and the high rises are. The idea, of course, that you have to make outdoor spaces that are somehow still feel intimate, even if your neighbors can live 30 floors up. Revisiting the project also for our latest book, where you see actually that the smaller patios that the houses had, they sort of partly covered. Some daring people have even managed to squeeze their car into the street. So that's something we have to learn from for the next time we're dealing with. And other architects continue to build in the same structures in nearby areas, although there's a little bit of densification that's slightly higher than what we did going on in between. So yeah, that's... That is a bit more radical, of course, and a bit more extreme. Then to another area again in India. One of my partners is there quite a lot. And there we started to build projects like these. So you also have this combination of extreme high rise and low rise. But here it's more, it's not so much a typological difference, but it's also more and less expensive ways of living. And here, complete areas are completely self-sustainable as well, with their own schools, power grids. So they can function completely independent because these middle-class neighborhoods are built to be independent from how the Indian cities are functioning. So it's a rather different environment to function in. But again, like in many of our projects, we try to incorporate urban, to incorporate lobbies inside the buildings, different types of typologies also within one building, to mix different types under construction, like I said already. And continuing also with other towers. So these photographs will be in the MVRDV 40 building. It's a bit like Adele, eh? Every couple of years make a new record. 20 years from now, okay, maybe 10 years from now. Right, so just to spice up the panel discussion later about density and also, of course, social diversity, which is also a topic which we'll come by later. Now we go to Vienna, and I thought this is also a very interesting project to show to you, because this is actually quite a generic tower in which different functions will be placed, retail offices, and higher up also apartments. Almost generic building, but one that doesn't deal with the traditional plinth and plinth building and top building. Still dealing with regulations about daylight sunlight on street level. And this time, this building does it by actually getting a waste. Yeah? So this building is simply twisted and squeezed in moments where you want light to enter the streetscape. So a lot of an interesting but slender building, which could maybe be also popping up in other high-rise densifying cities. And most recently, a project from us in the banking area on the south axis of Amsterdam, where this building actually has a two-sided development. For those with good eyes, you can all the time see a little bit how many houses and square meters the buildings have. Here actually is a kind of double-faced building that on one hand follows plot lines and adjusts itself to its neighbors that are offices and very corporate architecture buildings, and on the inside a completely other, almost organic world emerges, and the building suddenly appears to have Asian little mountains as an appearance, and this is seen from the roof. Now, this is not affordable housing, as you might imagine, but it's a bit more high end in Amsterdam, where, by the way, the housing prices are rising rapidly at the moment. Like in others, it's kind of more part of a global trend than of a Dutch trend, which means the prices in Amsterdam are much, much higher than in other cities. So that's something that passed by the Netherlands for a long time, but now we're also dragged into that development as well. So different solutions throughout the years for different questions, and but also you can see in Holland also the temperature and the levels rising. And even this example, this building, which is also an older building, but funnily enough, I still show and discuss in many, many countries. A building we made over 10 years ago in Amsterdam as well, which was actually the exponent, one of the last exponents of a Netherlands that always with a kind of new labor attitude, affordable and more expensive housing wrapped together in buildings. Yeah, the black and white building I showed earlier was a bit an exponent of that. There was a time in which in the Netherlands housing corporations were allowed to expand their business by also trying to build for those in their neighborhoods that were looking for houses just above the border of affordable housing, and preventing them from leaving meant adding extra houses to areas in which mostly affordable houses were built. This one was probably one of the most crazy exponents of that time, because it had low-income housing, middle-income housing, and high-income housing with 2, 3, 4, 5 bedrooms. And this is a sort of gigantic matrix of housing topologies, of which we didn't even know exactly how we would puzzle that into one building. We did suspect that, and on, of course, a prime location, before the prices started to rise in housing prices started to rise in Amsterdam, also because in the first two silos already a lot of affordable housing was made as well. So it's to compensate in this street the balance, the social balance of Amsterdam. Everybody had to be represented somewhere on that street. You see 4 parts. We had to make it as deep as the silos next to it. But what we didn't do is making 4 entrances. So that was an act, a little act of sabotage from our side. And we believed that we wouldn't need that, because we thought when we make so many different houses, it's actually more interesting to emphasize the absurd difference between those than to really clearly make a poor and a rich entrance. And I don't know, and then slowly the quality of bricks would get better and worse. I don't know, bigger window frames maybe. No, so we try to play with all this diversity, cluster it again into small, or what is called mini neighborhoods, and also play out different typologies on the outside and on the inside. So if you have a certain house, your window would be an expression of the house you have, including Corbusian unité houses. This is actually the same type of house that we did in this wooden in the houses in with the cantilevering houses for the elderly, because there's a group of elderly people living here. We managed to expand this dam that we were blocking with our building in the end with a new balcony, publicly accessible, but paid for by those who made this building. Like I said, we deliberately sabotaged separation inside the building by just making three entrances and connect everything with everything inside. Actually, with a pretty straightforward structure, if you sort of follow the lines from top to bottom, you will know that actually the structure doesn't vary that much. We did some things inside by which we could make different floor plans all the time. There's some exceptions to the rules, again, with beams to make, for example, a little harbor under the building. And if you look through your eyelids, you can still recognize how many different types of houses we were able to make. Also, sometimes with corridors, sometimes with galleries. So if you would walk through the building, you could make like a crazy route lingering through, crossing the water, where's that? Crossing water, looking down, et cetera, et cetera. So you could sort of wander through the building, have a look at the water from one of the balconies. And so after 10 years, they made a book, and that was really funny to see. So it's still a very strong community inside. And actually, the curiosity for the other is quite big. So people visited each other's homes. They organized tours. If you go to Amsterdam, you can book a tour with them. And living happily ever after. There's one slight problem, which is Airbnb. Because you suddenly have people in the building that are only there for a couple of days and sort of hang around and make dirty carpets, they told me. They make the carpets dirty inside in the corridor. So that's something I hadn't thought of when sabotaging and making it impossible to compartmentalize the building. So everything has changed now. Housing corporations have to limit themselves again to affordable housing, and the others do the rest. So this hybrid solutions in the coming years will not be made anymore, unfortunately, in the Netherlands. So we'll see what comes of that. Now this building with all the diverse housing in it, we turn into one big block, mimicking, of course, a silo or a pile of silos. So the difference is put together in one building. And it was also one of the discoveries that you can make extremely different facades and possibilities inside one block, and then still have the feeling of making one building. So when we were asked in Lyon to make a project with several different architects, and we were allowed to make the general layout, we decided not to go for this strategy, which is also cool and no problem, but to actually ask all the architects to stay within one form. Each one did inside pretty much what he or she wanted to do. There's just one limitation. You were only allowed to use one material and one window type. And that led to this to this configuration, which is very interesting because it goes beyond the individual architect's expression and you sort of get a bit humbler and make a block together. And it's quite popular now in Europe to cut things up. So to cut things up makes a human-scaled city is the idea. So when, as an architect, you are getting these commissions, it's not like what we did in China, that we have built the whole bunch, or in India, 1,000 units, 150, 200 is already a lot when you make a project in Europe. I think it's maybe a way to deal with architects and their egos. But we would, maybe the panel can give an answer to this. Because I have the feeling here that's less an issue. Right, this is a bit of a subtitle that come from another lecture, so I just skip to that next image as soon as possible. But anyway, in thinking about all these transformations and changes over the years, and also looking back at what happened to buildings, like we built our first housing project was for elderly, supposed to be people of 55 years and older, and in the end it was only 85-year-old people living in it because the waiting lists were too long. But also communities change, the way we live changes, the way we use our building changes. Isn't it actually maybe not interesting to make also a lot of buildings? And this is just a competition entry, and unfortunately it was never built. Where we actually, it's a bit like the Viennese project now, not really decide what it is that we are exactly making. Because, is it offices, is it housing, can it transform over time? Might be interesting in the future to make more buildings that are changeable. And actually, I used that in a workshop at the Berlage and called it a multiple. But you used the, I now I'm in Canada, I really used the word multiple for something completely different. But my idea of this multiplicity is that maybe we can already imagine in the buildings that we are designing a future use, or we can't imagine what it is, just that it will change. The only fact that will be for sure that it is what something that will change, because then we would have to limit ourselves to designs that have a possible use now, but also other possible uses in the future. Maybe helps us to think about height, building heights. Let's not make buildings too low. What are structures that can change from work to house and back, for example? But also maybe with a distinct character, eh? Because we can of course then only build the warehouses in the future, and then everything is solved. But it would also be cool still to have buildings with a nice character. So this is not produced building, so I can't really use it as an example, because it was never realized. Might be an image of that future building. And what is also interesting is that it can sort of show a certain individuality on one hand and be big and tall as well. So we did a lot of studies how we did that. But then again, maybe that's also these things that are in the air. Eh? We're talking about pixel and pixelation, and maybe that's also very 2007, 8, 9, 10, but it's now 2016 and we have to move on again. But it has a fatal attraction almost, I would say, to think about buildings in this way. And I'm also showing it again because I did a little bit of research before I came here and I noticed the type of condominiums that are built here in the downtown of Toronto. And I saw a lot of them have really tiny, tiny floor plans. And I was just wondering, like, what will happen to that in other times when you maybe need even more tinier houses, or that's worse, bigger houses, or when you live in one of those houses and you suddenly get children, or society changes and you have to take care of your whole family again, or I don't know, you don't need any of those houses anymore. And what will you do to those? So that's one of the reasons I put this building in the lecture today. And maybe again, a kind of feed for the panel discussion we will have afterwards. Another, I'm still in the housing section. Is that okay? Not so good. I'm going to speed up a bit now. I also sort of try to show a little bit trends and possibilities of what you can do. And one of the most important and strong tendencies I think we are having to deal with is that houses become products more. And if I say a product, you can also imagine that it has to do with that you can have a choice, that you can maybe customize it, individualize it. And that's also part of how we have to think about housing, I think, because our users are getting more and better informed. They have opinions. They watch to housing magazines and television series. They create their own kitchen with apps from IKEA. And so sooner or later, they really want to, and some places it's already happening now, want to, build their own condo. So the idea of multiple then, can get a whole new dimension. And even thinking one step further, as my partner Winnie did with the Y Factory and his students and our office, is then actually to give complete freedom to everybody to pile up his or her ideal house, of course. Now, this is just a strain in what we've been doing already for many years already as well, to think about how can we make maybe interactive software that at one point enables users and buyers to just pick their house and sort of virtually put it in a certain position. And then one day you go to the site and, oh yeah, that's my bungalow up there. I must admit, we're not quite there yet, but it does look very interesting, I think. So I have a feeling we might go in that direction. And why not? So from actually shoving certain houses through people's throats, you don't have a choice. This is the extreme other end. We also have to think in Uber categories of architecture nowadays. And this is definitely one where we are just designing the app that someone will use to make a building. Another one, which I always like to show when I talk about housing as well, is, of course, transformation. Because, in a time when you really restrict yourself to a lot of economic and technical restraints, you're, of course, you see houses becoming tinier and lower and more compressed and everything. And it's hugely interesting to see that once you come into the area of transformation, because these are actually two silos, that we transformed in Copenhagen, you allow yourself more freedom again and can invent other plans. So instead of drilling a lot of holes in the silos and making kind of pizza cake-like housing floor plans, we could use the heaviness of the existing structure to hang floor plates that have no structure at all. You just have to separate every now and then between the house, and you can create an amazing space in between as well, where you enter your houses. So that's, I think, the magic of transformation, that we give ourselves freedom and allow ourselves to do things that we don't give ourselves as possibility when we start from scratch, which was a nice discovery for us. Being Dutch architects, we were actually always making brand new stuff. We have felt really big pity for Italian architects or Spanish that had to deal with all this old stuff all the time, and nowhere, no liberty at all. And then when we started to do renovation, we suddenly realized, man, that's actually giving you extreme amount of liberty. You can get away from from a lot of conventions. Luckily, we were able to practice a little bit in Copenhagen, and just in time, because now in the Netherlands, we have a huge task coming towards us. In the past years, we've built much too many office buildings. So here's a group in Amsterdam that will be abandoned soon by ING, the bank. They go back to one building, and they just leave a lot of recently and less recent office building behind, like junk. On the same time, a lot of new houses are needed in Amsterdam, and in many parts of the cities in the Netherlands. So we were asked to make a master plan to transform the area, to check on whether we could reuse the offices and transform them into houses. Referring back to this idea of multiplicity and transformational, we realized very fast that the building on the top is the oldest building. It's from the beginning of the 70s. And those below are from the 90s. And the ones that were most easily transformable, the one that was most easily transformable was the oldest one. Because it was a bit over-dimensioned structurally. The floor-to-ceiling heights were much higher. Actually, it looked better as well. As we went down here, the younger the building, the more difficult it was to maintain. It's also not so deep. And that's, of course, interesting. So the opposite effect of what you might think. So this extreme minimalization, optimization, specialization, leading to very specific buildings that are useless once you don't need them anymore, because you can't transform them into anything else. You just have to demolish them. Turning the gray and the parking lots around the building into a continuation of a park that is already there along the canal, further down the road. Also allowed us to look at the building. So what we did is we cut them partly up, and hidden in these buildings are partly cores and basements and floor plates of the existing office buildings. We made tall structures so that we could open up the foot of the buildings as much as possible, make as much as possible public space. And then you might say, okay, is that really interesting that you are showing us this? Because yes, I think it is quite special in our context, and I don't know what it would be like here, because everything is privately owned land now. So somebody just bought these buildings, plus the spaces in between them, and could have also said, oh, I'm just going to fill it all up with houses and I don't let anybody, I let people cross through. But we managed to convince them to make a lot of diversity in the scheme, but also to open up the street level and to make it accessible for everybody, adding public functions to it as well. We're doing it in a rapid pace. In a municipality, the Dutch municipality sacked a lot of their urban planners. Everything is going liberal. So they're a bit in shock still and try to explain to the client what kind of light fittings he should use. But then the client says, well, I don't know, they're mine. So you can get parts of this back, but if you don't want to, I'll just put my own lighting fittings in. But the thing is, it's very interesting. So now we have a private client. We have housing shortage in the Netherlands for small houses for one or two people, teachers, nurses, policemen, etc. You might recognize the type of people I'm talking about. Should not be too expensive. And that is now being built for by private developers and pension funds. So that is interesting. So this role to build these houses has been taken over by the private market, and still with a conscience, I might say. I'd like to say what did help is that in the past 6 years we had a severe crisis in the Netherlands, a severe building crisis also. Nothing happened. It was a bit a great shakeout of developers also. So actually, the clever ones stayed, the ones with the good ideas, and the ones that just wanted to make quick profits mysteriously disappeared from the scene. So I'm also showing this to give a little hope to myself and to us all that together also with private clients you can have ambitions, you can make green floor plans with all kinds of technology. Architects among you will recognize it, to have ventilation through balcony areas, close of balcony areas, to make small floor plans that still have possibilities for adjustment. You can take out walls, you can connect to and have a bigger house, to put solar panels on the roof. We even have, this is one of the buildings. This is one we're working on right now. We're gonna put wooden structures on top of concrete structures to keep it light. Try to make even the building completely bio-based, which is, I realize now, a bit of a limitation because there are only very few materials still approved in this sense and usable for our project. So this is a weird floor plan because actually we built it on top of inside the office structure. We're even allowed here to make galleries. And then actually it's mostly the same floor plans, housing sizes as in the towers. But here, because we make a different configuration, you get a whole different atmosphere again and attract probably different type of people. So that's also good, I think, that when you build 900 houses, this I'm gonna skip because it's still under development. Because when you build 900 houses, I think it's very interesting to think about the diversity of making. It's not interesting to make 900 of the same houses. You are not the same than you and you and you. So we should allow ourselves a choice. Also important is that this private client voluntarily organizes neighborhood meetings to discuss the scheme, to ask for opinions and to ask for suggestions. And again, that's something that they have taken over this role from the government voluntarily. So I'm really, really very, very interested by these things happening. Still in the housing section, gonna speed up even more. This is something we discussed. This morning I talked to the waterfront organization. We talked about individual housing. This is just an urban scheme that we made of family row houses on top of a parking. Bit complicated story because what we did is this pollution soil. We put 1 meter of sand on the polluted, it's an old industrial area, and a parking garage. And on top of that, people were allowed to make their own houses. So they have a collective framework that is built, and then on top of that, each house can be built individually, again, in an affordable price range. Inside the city of Leiden, in a slightly poorer neighborhood, although this project sort of helped to raise prices very much. And what's interesting is that the cars disappear under the houses, and the streets have no cars inside. So the only thing we did here is we made urban design. We created this section and these fields. The length of the blocks is the length of a naturally ventilated car park, because otherwise it would become too expensive. And the rest has been filled in by each person individually. No guidelines, just stay within the urban framework. It's really a fascinating operation. So it's like really the consumers in control there. And we are just a designer. So it's not the software yet that we design, but more the hardware, you could say. And the strategy. Maybe I should skip this. There's a lot of nice images also. And even in China now, we've been building this high-rise, a growing awareness of appreciation also for the original housing of the Hutong. And different architects have been asked last summer to work on new concepts for the further development and revitalization of the Hutong concept. And that's, of course, really an interesting possibility to make diversification between buildings, to add new elements like urban gardening to it, but also art, and to try to revitalize and give a second life to this beautiful area. So from very low value, these areas are reinterpreted and reinvented again. But then I talk about it much too fast to tell you about all the details, so too slow. So this is not a hutong, but this is in Switzerland. And just switch back and forth, because, you know, it's under all these different conditions that it's almost like a little bit of a laboratory situation, where we try out different possibilities and reach the limitations of what the national culture can cope with. This is in a place called Emmen in Switzerland, after a competition won, where we proposed the client, again, this is family housing, but they imagined two houses on top of each other, multiplexes, to change the configuration in such a way that more people would have their houses accessible from the street level, which led actually to being able to build less, and then a strategy in the corners to make apartments, fill up the courtyard as well with housing, put roof gardens, roof terraces on the houses, the same we did in China, patios and roof gardens, and the same we did in the Leiden project on top of the parkings that I showed you, because when you want to make family houses in this case, of course, in more suburban condition, but still under denser conditions, you have to activate the roofs as well of buildings. You can't just give everybody a large garden, but outdoor space has to be redefined. And in this case, which is not something you can see yet in the drawings, people are able to buy the house in different levels of finishings. So you can buy just a casco, or you can buy something that is already completely done, which again allows for a kind of different financial approach. You can do things yourself, or you can say, I'll rather have a finished house. And the whole financing is, of course, an important aspect too. And I can tell you, but we haven't done that yet, that this strategy is also used in inner cities in the Netherlands, in neighborhoods that have to be renovated. They just strip parts, they strip blocks down, and they bring in water and electricity, and that's it. And then you can buy these hollowed out houses. You can buy one floor, you can buy two, three, or four. Mostly they're four stories high. Or you can buy together two. And then they are built in by people themselves. So for a relatively low price, you can buy a big space. And with your own hands, or with the help of friends, or with a contractor, you adjust this. And this is actually actively used as a reactivation of areas. And people spend a lot of time and money and effort in these. And it really brings up the atmosphere and gives a boost to neighborhoods. This is probably the smallest project I'm showing you, because apart from having too many offices in the Netherlands and in other parts of the world as well, we also have an abundance amount of shopping streets that are empty. Of course, everything moved into a mall or shopping center nearby. And what to do with all these streets? And the sad thing was that there was a museum in the street which was so monumental that in a previous restoration, they decided to move the entrance under the ground, which led to a sort of sad situation of this being the entrance of the museum. And I lived in this city for a long time, so I was always thinking, oh, this is really sad. And then also this space, which actually is in the middle, which they also didn't use, only for openings, as you can see. And we thought, yeah, well, there's a chance. At least this building can help to do something about this sad shopping street. And this is already after renovation. But so what we try to do here is to get the entrance into that empty space. So this is probably the smallest urbanization that I'm showing you today. Because also here we had a densification issue of what to do with the chapel, because this was the program as given to us by the museum. Slightly problematic if you do that in an old monumental chapel. So our verticalism here, I admit it's a bit of a joke that I'm showing you this, is just going up the wall. And of course, in a reversible way, because it's a monument, and they can take it away at some point. We're also not allowed to take away the organ and some other elements. So it's just going up. And because museums have shops nowadays. They have books, and they sell flower cans and all kinds of other stuff. And definitely also with the purpose to get out on the street, get people through the door, and hoping to be able, like an anchor store almost in a shopping mall, make this building work better again. So this whole idea of shops that are deteriorating. I was talking to you about the offices from the 80s and 90s. So there's a lot of garbage and junk around us. And so we can ignore it, of course. I mean, I see a lot of young faces. So you all hope for the future that you make fantastic new university buildings and Prada stores. And I don't know what you want to make, tall towers. But we have a bit of a legacy to deal with. So in Korea, we dealt with this one. And our vertical strategy of opening up and getting the street life back in, putting corridors to the street, we stripped the building and cladded it again, and with a cladding that could disguise all the ugly and whatever labels they had in this building. And you know what? They discovered in France as well that we could deal with these things. So this is a French, Parisian shopping area with hotels and offices that we are now currently in the process of converting and opening up to streets again. So this is also the revival of cities, I guess, and cars getting smaller and streets getting livelier again. An operation I will not go into. Another one in Lyon, looking like this. It could be anywhere where we even activate the roof, and we can go up on the roof of this building, and a new public plazas will be made and facades opened up again. A monumental renovation of a store soon to be opened in Amsterdam, where we had to deal with some historic issues, where the solution can be to make glass bricks. So it appears to be both at the same time. To be opened soon. And also, of course, we also have to deal with the cooler programs. It's not just shops and Botox clinics in Seoul, but also Roskilde Festival in Denmark that uses an old factory area nearby to create a rock school and a rock experience and all kinds of cultural things. So there, a strategy of putting things in and taking things out and some amazing claddings will also be opened in April. So for those of you who are in Denmark this summer, check it out. It will be cladded with real rock iconic materials as well. I'm not allowed to show the pictures yet because they didn't allow us to show it yet in lectures. And since you are broadcasting everything nowadays, I can't share any secrets anymore, even though I'm on the other side of the world. So that's the downside of these things. So you can see here how old and new structures are completed, are used and put together. If I then talk about transformation, let's make a little jump to bigger scales. There's also a lot of unused infrastructure or places where infrastructure used to be that we are working for. Now, this is probably the biggest competition I ever worked on, and we also lost, so that's pretty traumatic. anyway, it was a huge project. I really want to give credit to everybody we worked together with, including Grant Associates as landscape architect. And I think it's amazing because it really went to downtown of Singapore, right up to the border. So this is Singapore, basically, and it's a bit wider, of course, 24 kilometers. And there we had to make a lot of connections, connect to neighborhoods. And what was one of the most amazing things to think about is, on one hand, this stretch goes through very, very dense neighborhoods. And on the other hand, it's 24 kilometers long. So we could deal with thinking about microclimate. And on the other hand, it's like really like an ecological connection throughout the city, connecting mangrove with jungle, with all kinds of different landscapes. So our thinking started with Robert Long minimalist line through the landscape that could be used for both pedestrians and cyclists. Furnish it like it was a railroad track again, and then imagine possible architectures to punctuate here and there this site, like an observation tower to look to Malaysia, which is hermetically shut off with a huge fence with electric stuff. It's one of these hidden walls in the world between different second and first world countries, cutting right through the mangrove, viaducts that can be activated somehow when you suddenly throw some water down, you have waterfalls. So it's sort of strange, poetic, modern thinking about how highways can be fantastic. Picnic areas between offices and along the way, please build 3,000 housing units as well, Singaporean style. So that's actually why I'm showing this as well. This whole density issue, like, okay, so this is part of the park stretch, like. This is really hard to deal with. So the Amsterdam strategy of connecting towers at the bottom and the top again, orienting and rotating them to get as much as possible the ideal orientation of these buildings, putting public and collective functions on the plinth of and the roofs of this garden, and then try to sort of by clustering also make park again and a certain continuation as well of this 24-kilometer stretch. So playing with the typology, the natural ventilated tower, which is really fascinating to see in Singapore, a very dominant type where you don't have any technical or air conditioning, but actually you position all the rooms in such a way that air can always cross straight through towers. Because, for example, all the corridors and shafts, elevator shafts, are always open. And then it starts to look like this. But they won't be built because we haven't won the competition. I would have really loved to try out this one. But fortunately, you lose one, you win one. And in Singapore, in Seoul, we won the competition to create this huge park on the roof of an abandoned highway, of which you also have a couple. So I'm just making a suggestion that you could grow some plants on it. Not probably the same ones as in Singapore, but we'll be able to find out what grows here and can deal with the minus 20 as well. My time. I have 15 minutes left now, sort of. Okay, is that okay? Now we're going really fast. Vertical urbanism. So we went from pretty public housing to I'd like to show some public buildings where we definitely made vertical urbanism in that we literally pulled the street in. For example, in this case, where a library was supposed to be on the first floor of a building instead of on the ground floor, we just made a mountain of books with the street just You see the pavement here continuing, wrapping all around it like a Mexican temple, all covered in books, made of cupboards made of recycled plastic, by the way, and first of a series of buildings as well. And the roof is actually following exactly the maximum building volume on the site. And then when you start, because the whole story is also you need to use every surface you have on the building, the front, the back, the bottom, the top, and connect it all. It's not really a public building, but it's a tennis club where the same principle is used, where the roof is a tribune, where underneath it is the clubhouse. And together makes an enjoyable space. When we make a depot building in the downtown, in the center of Rotterdam, actually even in a park, a depot by definition, of course, a very closed building. A depot in this case, which has a public function, a looking function as well, which has an exhibition function, which will be opened up and built inside the museum park. A design by OMA, that's the Kunsthal up there in Rotterdam. So what we do is that we distribute all the program that is going to be public as much as possible around the building, on the outside, throughout the building to make the whole building have a exterior or street moving up, with public coming everywhere on all sides, with a roof garden. To compensate for the trees that are taken down on the site. And it's a new function also of museums, that they expose their collections, also the ones that are not in the museum, that they show how restoration work is being done. And that you get a fantastic cabinet of imagination and possibilities. So you kind of expand and make visible everything inside the museum, including also collections of private collectors that can be stored into the building, and then in the end a roof top on top of it. A public accessible roof on top of it. But you can say that's public building, so hey, there you are pretty much in control of things, and it's public funding, and everybody believes you that it's very necessary what you are doing, and the buildings are open to public anyway. So now what do you do when you make commercial buildings for private clients? Is it also possible there to open up, to make collective spaces and rental offices in Hangzhou, for example, near Shanghai? Can you do something with that? Yes, we can. For example, by, this is sort of an operation of four office buildings to be made, shaping them, orienting them in a different way, shaping them in the way that we get more shade, connecting them. So instead of this sort of sprawl of offices, cluster them so that this sprawl suddenly gets a new size dimension. And can make great spaces in between. So it's conventional office layouts, but still quite a remarkable area. And we could also imagine that it can become like a gathering place and a place where you can drink some coffee as well. Another hardcore commercial project was in Poland, in Poznan, but for a client with a lot of love for the city itself, and we were asked on the border of the 19th century city, where they also built a lot of new buildings, a Sheraton from the 80s, that's actually an old building, a student housing from the 50s. I don't know, it was a bit of a chaotic post-war situation, some older buildings as well. The city itself made up a kind of very strange figure, which was this one, which was given to us as an envelope, like it wasn't really deciding on whether it was a tower or whether it was a block edge. It was anyway much too deep to be an interesting building, and they didn't mind us filling up right up to the only historic building on the site, and That is one of the strangest shapes I ever made in my entire life. Completely hybrid. So one of the things we did there is that we said, let's create space again around this building. So everywhere, like the tower that has a waist, this building sort of at the ground floor steps back. Instead of a pitched roof, we make terraces so that people who work there can go out and probably smoke a cigarette because it's in Poland, but have some fresh air. Endless operations. I must admit, at first, the idea was just to, that the top, we even poured it in plastic, just pile a couple of blocks and you know, stay away from all of that. But then we were not allowed to do that, so we sort of started to shape and form and like, oh my God, this is really, oh, where are we going? And then actually concentrating more on the outside than on the inside, we started to make a square behind the building, stepping back from where the people get out of a subway, start to shape the street, make a gate, and form a plaza, add stairs to the building where people can sit in the sun. And here you see the only old building. And you know what? It suddenly started to have these very interesting different perspectives on all kinds of sites. It does mean adding a little bit of extra structure here and there, of course, to sort of, because suddenly the building has to cantilever out, and framing it with a material actually made very close to sometimes it looks like this, sometimes at other angles it looks like this, and then it looks, then that's it. And it's under construction, so you can witness soon if I'm right about this one. vertical urbanism, still private development in Oslo, a master plan we did, different architects building our master plan, mixed use, our idea not to cut the block up in the area up in different towers. On the back, on the front, the fjord, on the back, the train station, the central train station of Oslo. But slicing it up as a barcode, allowing every plot to be on the front. I've seen for your waterfront development, it's too late to go into this direction. But my it could have been a solution, Everybody on the first row, all buildings on the first row. Mix of functions, houses on top of offices even here and there, cutting through a pedestrian street. And we made one of the buildings ourselves. We were lucky enough to make one of the buildings ourselves, an office building. I won't go into that any further, but you can imagine that in this topology, again, this idea of multiplicity can find its place. So all the buildings, also from the other architects, you can imagine transformations can take place. Multiple functions are already put on top of each other. The buildings are also activated, at least one, our building is activated by putting logistic of the office building, not in the core, but on the outside of the building, as more as streets. There's lots of people working in this building. And they move around on the outside. The meeting rooms are on the outside. In the day and in the evening, you will see light. People working have different meeting areas downstairs, upstairs, so the whole building being used. And it's almost like a public street with inside the offices connected. And even the most commercial buildings, like this rental office again, can make gestures. This is in Paris, where a simple slab office is squeezed open to allow views from the street behind it. And so instead of a wall in front of them, this building opens up. It's also very sustainable, by the way, but I won't get into all the details, because you know what, everywhere in the world these principles are the same, a bit depending on the climate zone you're in, of course. in any case, fascinating that we could clad it completely in wood because of that sustainable ambition that we had, which also gives it a much more friendly appearance, I think. Yeah, so this idea of the street going up, you might say, okay, you're doing it in old buildings, but we also did it in a new building, like this shopping building in Tokyo that has a street winding around it, making shops on other levels to open up as well, and suddenly make windows. So instead of disappearing, I just put it in today because I thought, I see a lot here in Toronto that you just go into a building and then you disappear. I also heard today that there are paths and that there are lanes and that there are connections and bridges, but as an outsider, I'm not allowed to know about these. I couldn't find them. and again, it's fantastic, of course, then to suddenly have different things happening also on higher levels, and you have balconies, terraces. Bulgari opened a cafe, and that is fantastic, of course. Last but not least, it's the ultimate commercial building, of course. Commercial clients, rental, and sales, selling apartments, a market hall that closes at night, but still adding to the public life in a city. It is possible. And oh my God, we needed some of that in Rotterdam anyway, before market. There is a day market twice a week, but the rest of the week pretty much empty. And this project started around 10 years ago when there was a pitch between developers. Ours invited an architect as well, being us, to reinforce the bid with a vision as well. And I think what is also interesting, market halls were new for us as Northern European city. We did always go, when we go on city trips, with EasyJet to Southern European market, quite fond of that, of course. And in this period of time, I think our whole relationship with food has changed a lot. So we have now all these people moving back into the city. First of all, they don't have cars to go out to the mall. So food has to follow and follow back into the city. So all this urban, all this new thinking about food, that you want it fresh, that you want it, maybe it's even grown nearby, although that's not always logical to do. But this whole new relationship we have with food is very interesting. So all this comes together. This is on an abandoned railroad track. They also have fish inside that feed chicken or vice versa, I'm not quite sure. Here you see one of these blocks that are renovated, and then you can buy an empty house. Here's one of those projects. But they also bought a pig together and fed it and slaughtered it in the end. Yeah. Yes. So that's interesting. New relationship with food. So urban thinking again. Market hall, Dutch market hall, not so much money, low ceiling maybe. There are a couple built, but wasn't really inspirational. And condos and rental houses to be built. Could look like this, possibly. But could also look like this, was actually the simple turning things upside down. You know what you do sometimes when you make a model and I'm also a teacher, so I didn't also just pull off part of the model. I don't know if you recognize this gesture, or maybe you do it yourself. But in any case, this wasn't the first design. The first design was a bit more complex. But in the end, the operation worked because there was an issue of money, of course. Because the money was for the low market hall and condos and rental apartments. So the idea of how to build it had to be extremely rationalized, so to speak, making use of Dutch building ways of, I don't even know how to translate the word tunnel kisten, but an easy way to build with concrete apartment buildings, and then slowly moving them together. A topology also, well, the elevators in this building go straight up, so that also limits pretty much the way you can develop the section. And what is also important is that shopping and parking is at the bottom of it all, and was able to be squeezed down under the floor. So there it is. Now this is a photograph, and it's opened. So it was also built. So I'm going to show a little bit how it was made. That's the spot. So this is an old map of Rotterdam. Not recognizable anymore, of course. Rotterdam has its name from the river Rotter. That sort of also ran through. And in the 19th century, they built a train track on it. And later, they put the train under the ground. That is where the market was on. Bombed in the war, of course. But everywhere where you start to dig in this area, you find stuff. So part of the destruction period was taken up by digging in the ground and getting as much as possible out of the ground. When digging holes, they immediately start to fill with water. So the two contractors, one for the top and one for the bottom, and they had this sort of revolutionary idea not to pump all the time to keep the building pit empty, but build as if it's offshore industry. Like they build in the water, so the crane on an island in the water, the foundation underwater, and this is a guy who will dive in to put the steel work together for the concrete. And then when that was done, and if you go there in the parking, you can still see the walls of this pit, rusty and old. The conventional but slightly out of balance structure work going on, and finally the reward, a space inside that is just has the same height as the Tate Modern in London. So just gonna quickly go with you through the floor plans. There's a lot of market stalls inside, of course. Stalls that can also be used for cooling vegetables, which was one of the most important reasons to start thinking about building the market hall, is that part of it is stuff that was supposed to go inside because of European regulations, so we don't die when we buy food on the market. First two levels upstairs of shopping and restaurants. Also quite low levels downstairs. So when I started as an architect, we were still sort of two levels down. It was quite extreme in the Netherlands, you can imagine, with all this water. It's quite costly as well, but this is also, as cities become more dense and technique starts, you can go ever deeper and higher. And it becomes beneficiary. The food units, and here you see them under construction. Proud owners of shops, and they're quite clever also, because they discover there's also a lot of day tourism, so they also have they all buy sell snacks and drinks, and for foreigners they also sell small cheeses that you can take home, and it's kind of tourist stuff. A lot of debate in the city of Rotterdam that it's only for the rich, this place, and it's like really so this is a comparison made by one person in our office who checked out how expensive chicken is in the different venues can be found. Because the theory is that they have, from everything, they have a cheap, middle, and expensive variant available. So, there are a bit of struggles between people, because Jamie Oliver arrived, and then other pasta restaurants wanted to start a row, and there's roofs that are used, there's lots of things going on. Even the roofs of market stalls can be occupied, as you can see. and all kinds of shops. Oh yeah, here we get into the shops as well. And it's so very funny, indeed, with the book we had Facebook pictures popping up, show us what you did or thought of our building. But we also actively use pictures of usage and of users in thinking about what we did and learning for the future. Simple facade, it saves some money here and there. It's just the street, the same pavement as on the street is also the cladding. And one spectacular glass wall with very good engineers together developed by them that allows for a really transparent tennis net facade that could even move, I think 60 centimeters. But unfortunately, I at the first storm, I cycled to the building and hoped to see sort of, but I couldn't see. So, I don't know yet how to do that. I guess I have to sort of, we have to organize that one day to make that visual, I think. And also quite nice is that we have apartments. Now I should really speed up. The apartments we're still going underground here into the first level down, where is the delivery. It's a lot of fresh food, so you need vans going in and out. You need storage for the fresh food. There's a supermarket as well for all the stuff you can't buy on the market. That has an expedition out on the street. It sort of gets out of the street and then back into the street. Really very nice. And then, of course, it continues parking. Not hidden, but shown. And along the entrances, a stairs that goes down in time, and where all the archaeological findings are shown, like a kind of mini museum inside the building. And then, of course, the apartments themselves all have balconies. Some of them are, there's different topologies. 2, 3, 4 bedroom apartments. With outside and inside connection. You can also check out what's going on inside. Some of the inhabitants, Rotterdam population. The people living on the top having one extra feature. Oh yeah, I was telling you about the elevator, so I thought I'm here at the architecture university lecture. So there you go, there you have your limitations, of course, of bending. That's still getting into the house is an issue. The top level then has a corridor where you enter the different houses, and some of the houses, the top ones, have an entrance and then a stairs going up to the top level, and allowing for some spectacular floors that you can stand on as well. Patios and roof terraces. These poor people also have a really big balcony on the outside, so don't worry about them and their animals. So and they have this glance proudly opens. That's kind of interesting, no? You have like a market hall and condos and rental, and then the queen comes and opens it. Lots more people followed. It is really a big marketing success also for the city of Rotterdam. Our prime minister, you probably didn't recognize him, but he's chairing the EU in the coming half year, so he might be on your television as well every now and then. Yeah, success has many fathers. This is, of course, magnificent. He eats a piece of cheese. So I now realize how incredibly well this photograph is, and I'm keeping it on a little longer because the whole half of the Dutch consulate is present. Yes, and they sponsor us, so right. and it has an amazing advantage. And what is really stupid, so we can learn from this as architects, that this is not going to us. We actually designed some of this stuff, but we could have made a sort of little bit of a profit out of it. We didn't realize that. Well, anyway, merchandising, a wonderful ceiling designed by Arno Koenen and Iris Roskam in 3D is probably the biggest art piece in the world. I don't know. It had to be rendered. It's a three-dimensional image of floating fruit and vegetables, rendered at Pixar Studios because it was a huge, 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 huge image. Again, appearing on all kinds of things. And also interesting to see how it now pops. Yeah, how it appears in the city, in an environment with a weird collection of buildings. Anyway, that Rotterdam gave itself in the past years. The green plot actually will be built on in the future. Behind is a school that has its schoolyard on the roof. Also very interesting, and they can of course look into the market as well. And that's our public library, by the way. It's also a sort of Centre Pompidou-ish atmosphere around it. And unfortunately, just right behind the market hall are the cubic houses that maybe some of you know, that are sort of fascinating piece of architecture in Rotterdam as well. Some people trying to turn it into something more historic, as well, and actually the whole of The Hague is now full of skyscrapers like these, because it's a classical city, it has more brick. And then we also have one of those in Rotterdam. Fascinating. This is a station, by the way. Again, sort of the high-tech style. It's really interesting for architectural, historical architectural tour as well. Recent history in architecture. Well. Thank you very much for your attention so far, and let's go to the panel discussion.
So we're going to have a panel discussion. Our moderator is Elsa Lam, who is the editor of Canadian Architect magazine. She's written extensively for architecture and design history in various venues throughout her career. She was awarded the 2012 Phyllis Lambert Prize for writing in architecture for her doctoral dissertation completed at Columbia University under the supervision of Kenneth Frampton and Vittorio De Palma. Chris Glasiak is the Vice President for Planning and Design at Waterfront Toronto and is a passionate advocate for design excellence in the public realm. Under Chris's stewardship, Waterfront Toronto's projects in the 2,000-acre designated waterfront area have received more than 50 national and international design awards and nominations for their master plans, parks, and streetscape designs. Gary Switzer is the CEO of Maud Developments, Inc., and formerly led the high-rise division of Great Gulf Homes. His company's many award-winning projects are recognized for the design excellence and integration into the public realm. Gary has worked as an architect with WZMH and as a planner with the City of Toronto prior to becoming a developer. He is a frequent lecturer on development issues at the University of Toronto, York University, and Ryerson University. Peter Clues is managing partner and design director of Architects Alliance and has developed a highly regarded body of work over 35 years in Toronto, shaped by the clarity, simplicity, and functionality of modern architecture and by a steadfast commitment to urbanism and city building, renowned particularly for the quality of their high-rise residential portfolio. Peter speaks to professional, academic, and civic groups across Canada and the US on topics related to design, density, and urban renewal. And lastly, Craig White is managing editor at alternative media website urbantoronto.ca, which tracks architecture, public realm, infrastructure, and building development and planning in the City of Toronto and beyond. As managing editor, Craig, more than anyone in Toronto at the moment, has an encyclopedic knowledge of what has and will be built in the core at the moment. His broad overview of the varying degrees of success to which Toronto copes with the pressures of rapid growth on a daily basis will be useful tonight in our panel discussion. So, Elsa, over to you.
Thank you, Cheryl. What should I do here? Should I pull these towards us?
Yes.
All right. Well, thank you, Cheryl. And thank you, Natalie, for such a treat for this lecture and all of these amazing projects, some of which I'm aware of and have had the chance to visit, and others which were new to me. So it's amazing to see them all brought together and a feast for us to launch this discussion with. I think that one of the markers of MVRDV's work is the kind of level of typological invention. And in the projects you've shown us in particular, this kind of weaving of public and private space in unusual and unexpected ways. So I'll launch with a question to the panel just to give you a chance to have a sip of water and relax after speaking for during the lecture. So I'll launch the question to the panelists about, you know, how in Toronto, which maybe doesn't have such an overt typological invention, or perhaps doesn't usually have such overt typological invention. What projects you've, maybe if you could launch an example of one project that you've been involved in or have followed closely that is either a spectacular success or perhaps a provocative failure in this realm of working with vertical urbanism in an inventive way. Who wants to start and pick that one up?
Chris,
we'll just work our way down the table,
if
you'd like.
Only the successes.
But of course, that's all I would ever talk about are the successes. Well, it's a good question. I mean, vertical urbanism is a bit of an interesting one for the waterfront, because we haven't really developed too many tall things yet, at least not under the purview of Waterfront Toronto. But I think if you're talking about typological mixes, I think a very small example, but a really successful one, is one of the slides that you put up there, which are the wave decks that were built at the heads of the slips. And those came out of a design competition process. It was actually won by a Dutch firm, West 8. But they took what everyone had an expectation would look a certain way and came up with something different. So there was an idea that we needed to widen the sidewalks there, and I think everyone assumed that meant we would create a flat plain. And instead, what West 8 did was they created a landscape out of it. They created, recreated, if you want to say that, in a way, the kind of topography of Georgian Bay. So we have that kind of undulating way that you move along the shoreline at Georgian Bay, up and down the rocks, brought down to the waterfront. I don't think it's a literal copy. I think it's a very effective copy, but I think it was a challenge because it's not what you expect in public space. It's not what people expected out of a dock or out of a widened sidewalk. But I think they're very successful at making something that was going to be used really to serve a mobility function into a place.
Well, I would say that, as opposed to in Europe, the public realm in Toronto, I think, is primarily the streets. Toronto was never really designed with piazzas. Our parks are really, you know, leftovers from, you know, where Queen's Park was part of designated for government and for the university. We really don't have, if you think, what's your favorite public space in Toronto? People might say Nathan Phillips Square. But I think in my own, from my own recent projects, we're doing 5 St. Joseph, which is just north of Wellesley, not far from here. I think Yonge Street is probably, you know, the main street for Toronto, the primary ongoing disappointment, let's say, over the last couple of years, a couple of decades, in terms of, you know, everybody's saying, what's wrong with Yonge Street? And now it's the city's almost gone in the reverse. How do we preserve Yonge Street with new planning guidelines? And, you know, as the councillor has said repeatedly, she doesn't want Yonge Street turning into another Bay Street filled with high-rises. So I think with 5 St. Joseph, what we ended up doing was preserving almost, you know, half a block of historic buildings on Yonge Street, setting back far enough that they were kept in their entirety. And then on St. Joseph Street itself, the city did allow us to just retain the facade, which was the largest facade retention in Toronto's history, being so tall and so long, and then allowed us to rebuild St. Nicholas Street around the corner. So here we've got three levels of public realm from Yonge Street to St. Joseph to really a back lane that it's not 100% finished right now, but already I think, Craig has told me that on Urban Toronto, you know, was voted, you know, one of the favorite projects from the public, mainly because of, I think, the quality of the heritage restoration, and then also the quality of the tower, which was you know, we didn't try to mimic the Rotterdam tower and put a little, you know, gable roof on top. It's a very contemporary tower that was designed to be in contrast with the heritage components.
I actually think your question is actually a really, really good one, a very insightful one. It's somewhat rhetorical in a way. I think what is really interesting about what and problematic about what is going on in the city is this rapid densification. We saw Natalie's slide from 2001 to 2016, and the overlay of that density, which comes as a result of a provincial planning initiative. And it we're dealing with a city that can't really cope with it in any kind of comprehensible way. We are completely focused typologically on one type, which is the point block tower, and that's codified in a series of guidelines called the tall building guidelines. And what we're creating essentially, including our office, is a series of buildings that are so similar that we kind of border on the danger of becoming a banal place. And if we look at Toronto, and we think about Toronto, in our office is one of the offices, and I really admire your work because you built your office on housing, and we've built our office on housing, and it's typically a building type that a lot of, I would say, fancy pants people don't really do, architects, because it's so difficult programmatically and from a budget perspective, but it's a really, really important part of the building of any city. And in Toronto, I didn't grow up in Toronto, but I came here after school. And if you look at it typologically, it is almost a completely intact 19th century Victorian city that in the 60s was overlaid with slab block apartment buildings. And as in forest kind of succession where you get grasslands, the forest, there is no succession here. It went from houses to slab block apartments. Early in our practice, we did look at quite a lot of varied typologies in housing from 20 Niagara, which is on the kind of the western section of the downtown, with this idea of clustering apartments around elevators, which is a very European idea, to a project we did on the east section of the city, which is where we had kind of skip-stop corridors and units that all looked west, even though it was a two-faced building. But more laterally, we are really devolving into this idea of homogeneity, which I think is problematic. And I think it really needs to have a proper kind of conversation and public engagement, that we should be less concerned about the form of buildings and more about how those buildings are defining public space, so that we don't get 750 square meter point towers everywhere, and all we argue about is height and the separation between those buildings. And I think this is a real issue, that we need far more typological diversity in our housing, which we would get if we stopped the codification of buildings and more concerned ourselves with how those buildings are, as they say, to create the public realm.
I think I can build on that in terms of looking at where Toronto has ended up post-2005 and Ontario's Places to Grow Act, which created the green belt around the city and has created real demand for housing within it, which is feeding on itself as it became more difficult to build subdivisions around the city. New housing came back into the core, making the core more interesting, making it more desirable to live in the core yet again, and the buildings get taller, the land values go up and up and up. Developers must build taller to make the money back from the land they've been spending, or the money they've been spending on the land. And as Peter was saying, we now have this particular typology that's pretty much a result of similar parcel sizes that we're dealing with, and everybody is fitting their buildings within, or now trying to fit them within the tall building design guidelines, and we are coming up with this sameness. And I suppose because of very similar road widths all over Toronto as well, we have a sameness generally to the public realm as well. And we see on Urban Toronto at least that people are getting more frustrated with that sameness all the time and are looking for places for more individuality for the buildings and more expression, I suppose, than what we're seeing lately. Going back to something, well, maybe Chris could have talked about, but he didn't, was the West Don Lands that Waterfront Toronto will essentially be springing upon us later this year, which is going to be quite different from what we see generally because there was a vast tract of land there, the intention to keep building heights lower, a lot of attention is being paid to public realm in there, far wider streets. We'll probably end up talking about it more today, but yes, we have a particular typology that marks most of the city now, but it's not the only thing that's out there. Peter's company is involved with that as well. I suppose if I should get Gary into this mix too, Gary's one of the few developers out there who is maybe dealing with these typical blocks of land and yet is approaching it differently. And if you do know 5 St. Joseph, as Gary's mentioned already, you know that. If you know his development called the Massey Tower, which will shortly be coming out of ground just across from the Eaton Center, just south of here, that's going to be going up behind a Heritage Bank building. Gary has a few more things in the works that where the public realm is number one, I think, and at least that seems to be what's coming about from that. So, getting there.
I want to talk about Massey Tower and Pan Am Village, but I want to bring Natalie into the conversation to react in a way first. And you've had enough of a break now. and maybe to speak a little bit about the conditions that allow for this kind of inventiveness and the kind of challenges that you've come across. Because I think we have a tendency to always feel like the grass is greener on the other side, and in the Netherlands you can do anything, and in Toronto you can do nothing, and poor us. But certainly there must be many challenges that you face, not only technical but also political, in terms of some of the propositions that you've made.
Yes, but I also like to respond a little bit to what I heard before. Maybe I will answer your question as well, but what you asked me. I am, of course, just a visitor of this city, and I've been here a couple of times briefly. So all the things that I see and feel are really from this sort of short impressions that I'm getting. And I was already trying yesterday to explain to some people that what catches me in Toronto is that I'm trying to figure out what is this city actually. So I'm out on the street, and what I feel is transition. So I, of course, I'm a visitor, but I'm also a professional. So I feel that something is changing, but I'm not quite sure in what direction. And I sense sometimes that I pass streets and I am in streets that are somehow more significant than others, but I also don't quite understand the differences between streets here. So that maybe has to do with this block typology. So it's sort of directionless as well. And what I also think is, so you have this huge densification, this image I showed you, and there's actually a lot of housing added also to the city, but still I also see a strange emptiness. Oh, I've been here very short, but I think, where are all these people? And then I realize, hey, there's a door out there. It was the Eaton Center, actually. And I go inside, like, oh, my God. I went downstairs into the food court. Wow. And then I wanted to cross to another block. And I thought, maybe I'm clever. I'm going downstairs, but I hit a wall. So then I went up again, and I ran across the street. There was no way connected. But the problem is I didn't know there was a connection, probably. But I couldn't find it. So to me, it seemed like there were sort of these islands with a lot of people inside, hardly visible from the outside. I also couldn't really understand on the outside what was happening on the inside. And I was a bit clueless, actually, out here on the streets of Toronto. So my question was actually to some people, like, where is this heading? What is the idea of Toronto? I had a little bit less when I was here 10 years ago, but then I gave a lecture to John Daniel, so I was mainly around that area there, which might be, maybe I'm just in another area now, and I haven't had that before, I guess, to be in a city, and it's sort of maybe in very low-rise, large cities. This sort of desertedness and directionlessness of a city. Maybe I'm a bit too vague now, but...
Your reaction is very much, I did a building a number of years ago with Stefan Benisch, and that was his initial reaction of Toronto. Mm-hmm. And he was staying at a hotel on the east side of the downtown, and our offices on the west side, so he would take to walking along one of the streets. In this case, it was King Street. And asked the same question, where is everybody? And then one day he went down into this very strange place called the Path System. You go down there, and that's where everybody is.
Yeah.
And because 6 months of the year, or if we're honest, or perhaps 4 months if we're optimistic, the weather in the city is so horrible that you go down there. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of actually perverse. And what's curious is the city is promoting this path system. Mm-hmm. It started as a modernist idea by Mies van der Rohe with the Toronto Dominion Center of creating public space in a plaza with his very handsome buildings. And where do you put the commercial? You put it down below to maintain the purity of this kind of partie. And then it just started expanding with tentacles. Mm-hmm. And now it's considered a very good thing. And the city will ask you to connect to the pass system. And I actually think it's kind of completely perverse. Mm-hmm. So you have to come back here in the summer because then all those people come out from the basement.
Right, yeah.
And it's really quite a wonderful city.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah. No, but so to really answer your question, yeah. Elsa, I think a lot of places we go that are dealing with densification, we have these issues of things moving up, moving down, and moving inwards, together also with more and more privatization of space. There's a lot being said and written about, of course. So, and then on the other hand, we all love so much the street and public space. So there is the paradox, actually, I think, that a lot of us have work and commissions that go in completely the other direction than, on the other hand, what people say that they want and what we all apparently also like still very much is being out there on the street somehow. So this is something we somehow have to solve and deal with in our work. And so one of the things I also said yesterday is to somebody, I had a reception and I talked to a lot of people, maybe people should talk to each other here. And but that's a very Dutch thing to say, because we always have to talk to a lot of people. I mean, even if we don't want to talk to others, we are always constantly put into circumstances where people have to communicate with each other and talk and talk and talk.
So, Natalie, I think next time you're here, you come in the summer.
Yeah, all right.
You have to go to Queen West, College Street, Roncesville, Bloor West Village, the beaches. You know, yeah. So you know there are people on the streets, and mm-hmm. I think, you know, going back to Peter's point, I think Toronto's always had a very ambivalent attitude towards density. Mm-hmm. You know, this is a city of single-family homes. You know, unlike Montreal, which was a city of apartment buildings, mm-hmm. Apartments. When you think about, I don't think we even had apartments in the city until maybe 1910. At which point, you could still see some remnants on Avenue Road going up the hill there, but essentially, you either lived in a house or you lived in a rooming house. If you know, really after the war, demographics changed. Downtown got transformed, streets like Jarvis Street, the houses went, replaced by apartment buildings because people were starting to live alone. But I think what's very interesting is that when you think back at, there was a firm which Diamond and Schmidt comes out of, which was Diamond and Myers. They were one of the first to say back probably 1975-ish, saying, let's take the high rise like this, which everybody was against high rises, and there was huge fights in High Park, in you know, notorious, because they were demolishing single family neighborhoods to put up the tower in the park. So what Diamond and Meyer said was, let's take the tower and let's lay it on its side. And the perfect example of that is there's a project not far from here called Dundas Sherborne, which essentially took an entire block of Victorian houses and then did a six-story terrace building behind it. I think it kind of turned into a bit of a social disaster, but I think that had more to do with the demographics, and also the whole public realm issue was not quite worked out in terms of fronts and backs and this sort of thing. But that premise, I think, then evolved into the St. Lawrence neighborhood, which was our historic heart that had basically been, you know, it's as if it was Rotterdam after the war, sea of parking lots. So, like, I even remember, you know, working down there in the 70s, and it was all parking lots down there. Jerry Markson, Canadian master of the modern movement, designed Market Square, which was essentially eight stories around a courtyard. That was sort of seen as, okay, here's our new model for the future. We don't want high rises. We don't want those awful apartment buildings that have blighted. This is the thinking at the time. Mm-hmm. Let's build all these courtyard buildings. So if you look at the original design for the, what's known as the railway lands, which is where the Dome Stadium is and everything south of the tracks, it was all going to be market squares. It was all going to be courtyard housing, eight stories, until the recession hit. And essentially, Concord Pacific from Vancouver bought the land for almost nothing and said, we don't want to build courtyard housing. Nobody wants courtyard housing. We'll build a mixture of point towers and low-rise, like we did in Vancouver, and we'll have the best of all possible worlds, because we'll have vibrant streets with townhouses and shopping, and we'll have the density in the point towers, which gives everybody you know, light and view and privacy. I don't know where the sound just went. But anyhow, I think that's part of the problem. And actually, one of the early buildings I did with Peter is 18 Yorkville, which is up at Yorkville and Yonge. That was trying to blend. We did a mid-rise building on the side street, and we did the point tower right on Yonge with on a podium. The city objected to it. The city said it was too tall at 36 stories. And this is only 10 years ago, 12 years ago, that it was too tall, and it was one of the first point towers in the city. But I think what ended up happening, as Peter was saying, is that the city then latched on to that model and said, okay, you want density, you know, forget about, they're not saying forget about mid-rise, but essentially if you want to achieve those densities, it has to be a point tower, has to be a podium. It's going through my mind looking at your slides. Most of the buildings you're showing would never be permitted in Toronto. They would not comply, well, especially the Viennese building with you know, taller at the bottom than cutting down at the, like, none of those would. Now, the planning staff might say, well, we'd make exceptions, but that would break every rule in terms of, or the limiting distances between all the buildings.
Mm-hmm. I was going to just, yeah, I just wanted to jump in, because I think what you've touched on about people on the street, though, goes a little bit deeper, no pun intended, than the weather. And I think, you know, like any relationship, there's two sides to it. And so I think the path certainly is an attractive way to avoid the cold weather. But I also think Toronto has built a very unattractive public realm at street level. I think, you know, this city came of age at a really bad time when the automobile was kind of the vision of the future still in the 1970s. And all of our streets are really the remnant of a design idea about streets as a vehicular movement system. And I think compounding that is Toronto came of age in a time when there was a real belief in the notion of secondary level circulation for pedestrians. So we were going to achieve a kind of utopia by turning the streets into just a means to move cars around, and people would kind of float around on the second level. And so what's happened is the public realm is very uninviting in Toronto compared to cities of this size and with this much wealth. Our sidewalks are shockingly narrow, poorly maintained, cluttered with stuff. And as a result, they aren't really a place where the life of the city can be conducted in a way that it is in cities with a bigger, more generous public realm. We're going to face a challenge here, though, in trying to reclaim that space, because we now have this new group of movement users, which are cyclists. And, you know, when I moved here 10 years ago, I thought, you know, one thing the city could do would be to take some road space and give it back to the sidewalks. That's hard to do now because we're trying to take road space away and give it to the bikes. But I think there's a huge resource there that's very underused, and Queens Quay is the best example. I mean, that street was a very uninviting, very not populated place before we rebuilt it and opened it this past summer. And again, it had the 4-foot wide sidewalks on either side, 4 lanes of moving traffic, a very concrete TTC transit median in the middle. And there was really no ability to kind of actually live on that sidewalk or have a public experience there. It was, you felt very much like it was designed to move you through and get you to where you were going. And people would say, oh, there's never anyone down at the waterfront. So when we first set out to do this, people said, well, you can't do anything about Queens Quay. There's not enough space. It's, the street's too small. You know, if you've already got narrow sidewalks, you've got to have 4 lanes of cars, you can't get rid of the streetcar, and we need to add bike lanes. And so when you add up the need for all of that on a mathematical basis, if you want sidewalks this wide, bike lanes have to be this wide, you need a right-of-way that's much wider than what's there because it's all built out, and that was very much the perception. So it was really through design that I think we solved that problem and came up with a whole different idea. And what's amazing to me is right after we opened Queens Quay, it was just filled with pedestrians on a scale that the waterfront never was before that. And I don't think it was that some magic happened and suddenly there were more people. I think there is pent-up demand for that space and we're not providing it. So people find alternatives like the path and kind of root their lives around them because we don't give a lot of reward back on the public streets in this city, but Queens Quay gives you a reward and it gives you a stage for urban life to take place on. You can actually stop and chat and you're not suddenly in the way of everyone else. So I think the city's going to experience a bigger and bigger crisis in this department. And I think our very parsimonious attitude towards what we spend on the public realm is going to have to change because we're densifying at such a rate. We're never going to provide the parkland ratios that you would really want because there aren't sites left to produce the parkland. So there's going to be a lot of pressure on the streets in the public realm to provide that social mixing valve, to provide that place for people, compounded by the fact that our developers are building minuscule condominium units now. So it really is going to push people out onto the street more and more. When you live in 250 square feet, you're not going to spend a lot of time inside. And if there's no parks anywhere near you because the city didn't build them at the same time that the condos went up, the public street's really the place you want to go. And so it's going to have to be really envisioned almost as a parkscape, almost as a place. And the landscape architecture profession, I think, is pushing us in that direction now anyway. But I think it's going to be critically important for Toronto, or I think we're just going to, you know, continue to scurry around underground and continue to hide in our condominium towers, and we won't talk to each other the way you're saying we all need to talk to each other. You need a forum to do that in, and the public streets are one of the forums.
I want to pick up on what you said about the problem of Queens Quay in a way being a problem of imagining it a different way. And I'm curious what Natalie and the other panelists you might see as, you know, just a blue sky for a moment and to kind of forget about the strictures of planning department and so on. I mean, what are these other hidden opportunities that might be inherent in Toronto's fabric for a different way of doing things? It wasn't on my prepared questions list, so I'm just kind of throwing it out there.
So we can't possibly have an idea about it.
I can start. Yeah. I mean, I think what Chris has observed and practiced through Waterfront Toronto takes an outsider to actually understand the city and the lack of a coherent and compelling public realm. The city is now just starting to grapple with this in an initiative called TO Core. And the problem is there's no public land to do parks. And so we are going to increasingly be faced with this idea of incentivization of developers to actually provide that public space, whether it's privately owned and publicly accessible or whether it's publicly owned and publicly accessible. There's all these kind of weird hybrid descriptors going on in the city right now. And in a project we did with Gary, he referenced earlier, 18 Yorkville, we actually provided a public park as part of that and provided a different build form. That's why we introduced the idea of a point block, because we thought it was it removed a section, the footprint of the site, to allow public space. And then that kind of went nuts with point towers everywhere, but no public space. And so moving forward, I think the city collectively, I don't mean the planning department particularly, but everyone, including developers, is first it starts with the notion, and any of my clients who might be here should block their ears, developing in the city is a privilege, not a right, and that we need to acknowledge that and give back to the city in terms of public realm. And we need to, what Waterfront Toronto has done is extraordinary, but it has used an extraordinary amount of public dollars to do that. And we also need the private sector to come in and actually start to create those spaces and do it in an incentive basis where perhaps you get more density or you get it in a better configuration, whatever the development objectives are, in exchange for the giving back of the public realm. And so it may not just be in parks, and I'm having this like insane argument with the Parks Department right now where parks can only be square because that's the way they program them. And I go, parks could also be linear. There could be connectors from block to block. They could be hard. They don't need to be soft. There's all sorts of different qualities and characters of public space that the city desperately needs.
But if I could jump in, when you're built, as you know, Peter, when you're building downtown, you build to the lot line. You know, the city doesn't want you, and you wouldn't want to set back from, you can't create public realm on a typical downtown site because you are building to the edges, unless you're doing a very large property, you know, like the Mutual Street parking lot, where they'll put a park in the middle of an entire block. But on a typical site, you don't. I think, and if any of my colleagues in the development industry are out there too, I think we need to have better architecture. Because really, if the issue is not about, you know, people going to a park, or it's a question of having a beautiful, well-designed building out of how it meets the street, what's happening at grade. You know, are you designing a grade that you actually could put in retail that succeeds instead of just a bunch of nail shops and things because the ceilings are too low and the widths are too narrow, to do in a proper retail space that you have the sidewalk cafes? Because I think, and Natalie, maybe you can jump in, I don't see anything wrong with the small units from the point of view of it is addressing a need for people to have affordable housing. And in a sense, like Europe, we were just talking to somebody on the weekend who lived in Antwerp for 5 years. It was only on the fourth year did she ever get invited over to somebody's home for dinner, because it's not a traditional European thing of saying, oh yeah, we just met, come over for dinner. You meet at the cafe or you meet at the restaurant. So there's a much more vital public life because the life is lived more outdoors because of that. So I think we have to concentrate more on what is happening at grade of all these new buildings. Of course, we're going to do the, you know, streetscape improvements and tree planting where you can, and this sort of thing. But I think we have to concentrate on how it's meeting the street more.
Well, I was actually thinking about this as well when I looked at all kinds of alleyways that you have here. And that must have been because this summer I was in Australia, in Melbourne. And I suddenly have a feeling that I could take a saw and sort of cut out some stuff from the blocks that you have, and you suddenly have a different width and side, and you have already a lot of underused alleyways, I noticed.
And there is an initiative downtown, like actually right near here, O'Keefe Lane, and going up and down east of Yonge, to try to do something with that.
Which is still very urban.
But the frustrating part is also we have miles and miles of back lanes in the residential communities that are surrounding downtown. That the city, again and again, absolutely refuses to entertain the idea of muse housing, which is very traditional in Europe, mm-hmm. that you could be adding thousands and thousands of affordable units if you actually use the back lanes of, mm-hmm. you know, streets out by Palmerston or going further west. The the issue for the city always is it's not wide enough for a fire truck, it's not safe, and it's always...
But it's used as construction lanes, I saw today. Even.
The which?
As a lane for construction, even.
This is craziness.
So if you can build a tall skyscraper using those lanes, you can probably also...
And I think it's also a political issue that the trade-off for allowing all the tall buildings downtown is that the surrounding neighborhoods of single-family homes don't get touched, ever.
And what about the roofs? Because I've been up in some towers the past couple of days. I've been looking down on a lot of gray. And since you are so consistent in making these plinths, you actually have another level in your city also that is quite underused. And it's indeed also, the discussion is also about what idea do you have of what city is. And of course, it's not just having a lot of people out in the street and everything is all right. I understand that, of course. There are different types, and maybe it's fantastic that it's quiet here in winter, and it's helping but I'm serious about it. It's just a preconceived idea that it's good that there's a lot of people in the street. Wait until you've been to Prague or Amsterdam.
Or Venice.
Or Venice, for that matter. And you're so happy to be in Toronto, where it's so quiet. And Yeah.
There is.
So what is the idea of urbanity as such? But yeah, there's capacity in here, in this city, that is not used, indeed. Yeah.
There is more going on with roofs these days. It's starting.
Like the Molson hockey rink?
Well, actually, I'm thinking about, condominiums now have, there's a requirement for both outdoor and indoor amenities for the residents. So the outdoor amenities are ending up on the top of podium roofs these days. Part of the podium roofs are also becoming green roofs. The city requires some kind of cool roof up there, and typically now it's going green. Some of the developers are putting in planting beds for kitchen garden type things, and those have been proving popular lately. But we know of a couple of developments, one where a public plaza came out pretty much up at Yonge and Eglinton recently, where a new shopping expansion went in instead, and four floors up this spring there will be a new public space opening there. It was highly contentious to take that public plaza away. It'll be interesting to see how that neighborhood responds once there's privately owned public space on that podium. And then there's another one planned in Yorkville, so on Bloor Street. People will know where Holt Renfrew is now. There's a 73-story tower planned for part of that site, and an 8-story retail podium on top of that 8-story retail podium is meant to be another privately owned but publicly accessible space that hasn't been fully designed yet, but the intention is to get some green space back into that incredibly densifying part of town. Mm-hmm. So there's a recognition that that kind of space can be used, but we are just getting there. Mm-hmm.
I think there's a need for more landscape design in these spaces, and because I think that Peter's right, that one way we will get open space is through the provision of it on private space. But at the same time, I think we have a sameness in our buildings. We really have a sameness in those spaces. They all tend to look the same. They all have one bench. They have a fountain. They have a flowering tree. And it's just this kind of endless repetition of the exact same thing, with the idea that somehow multiplying it creates a more richness. And I think it doesn't do that. I think it just becomes, every plaza feels just like the plaza right next to it, and there's no diversity of experience to be had. And you get that out of a bigger park space, naturally. You may be able to get it out of these smaller bonus plazas, but I don't think anyone has quite found the recipe for that yet in Toronto. And you know, we build them on every project. The first thing the planners always say is, well, where's the publicly accessible open space?
But in a way, Chris, Waterfront Toronto, I think, has been a hero in terms of at least what you've been doing is going out and hiring international or local first-rate landscape architects, which know how to design these spaces. I mean, you saw some of the pictures up on the waterfront and at West Donlands. The problem with the City of Toronto Parks Department is there's no design. I mean, there a combination of bad designers there and no maintenance. So here we give the park at 18 Yorkville to the City of Toronto, and designed by Janet Rosenberg with hedgerows and topiary modeled on a park in Paris. Within a year, the whole thing looks like it's shambles. You know, weeds everywhere, overgrown, the plants are dying, the benches are falling apart. And the city says, well, we have no money to maintain these things.
So this is a fundamental problem with Toronto, which is based on a philosophy and political position in which public spaces should be, that are owned publicly, should be maintained publicly. And if you look at some of the great cities of the world that have densified, like London or New York, there is a huge component of public spaces that are maintained privately. Because there is a kind of a vested interest in a building or a collection of buildings that front onto a square, that square is beautiful and maintained. And somehow we have to get over this ideological conundrum we have, which is there's nothing wrong with private sector maintaining public spaces as long as they're publicly accessible. So this is a big issue. And I just want to go back to your, we do have to provide, the private sector does have to provide public spaces. And the problem, it's kind of circular, it comes back to this idea, this earlier question of typological kind of homogeneity. As long as we focus as a city on one building type, and we create through the bifurcation of blocks, through individual land ownership, the inability to provide public space. Because we say, well, I bought a property that's 15,000 square feet, and I can just barely get a tower on it, so where do you want me to put the public space? We have to look at blocks completely in their entirety and say, we don't care what the lot ownership is. And this is heretical, I know to say. We have an idea about how a block should develop, and we're going to drive connectors through it, or we think there should be a public space in the middle of that block. We don't care who owns it.
Isn't that called planning?
Yes. So this is what, in a very robust way, Midtown Manhattan did between the wars, where they said, with those famous Hugh Ferris drawings, We're not going to tell you how to build buildings. We're going to say how to shape blocks to allow sunlight down to the intersections of the streets, for example. So if you look at on the intersections of avenues and streets in Manhattan, there's always sun, if it's a sunny day, at the intersection at a particular time of day. And that's all in the shaping of the building. That's a big idea. And then you allow the private sector to say, okay, so I want to make money, and I'm going to build buildings, and they've got to be commodious, and they have to have beautiful apartments that people will buy and live in. But we'll do it within a scripted idea of the definition of the public realm. So in this new TO Core initiative that Jennifer Keesmaat is rolling out, absolutely, and I believe they're going to do this, but they've got to be bold, not timid. Say, no, we want these spaces. And if you, Mr. Developer, want to develop this and build a 60-story or 100-story tower, you're going to have to give back and provide these spaces so that as an adjunct. Because the brilliant thing that Waterfront Toronto has done is, and we've talked about it and sat on the design review panel, did the Pan Am Village, is that you lead with the public realm. And because you have the luxury and ability to do that with public land ownership, and that is one way to do it. But, you know, when we're backfilling the downtown, we're going to have to lead with the public realm in a different kind of way. And I think that that's going to be the big challenge going forward. And planners have got to stop talking about planning policy from being in school in 1970 and what we believed in this kind of socialistic idea, and embrace this and say there's an amazing number of people who want to live in this city, and which is fantastic. And we have to harness that energy and that need and desire and create truly extraordinary city. And we can do that. And your observation about the laneways is absolutely right on. That is a starting point.
So Peter, what do you think about?
I'm not sure.
Decades of planning have led to places like Liberty Village.
That is a fantastic. This is this horrible area. When I have visitors from Toronto come in, I used to say, and they're coming from the airport. Don't look at the what was called the Tobacco Motel Strip, because that's really, just close your eyes till you get into the, because at least in the downtown core, there's this kind of energy of tall, robust buildings that in aggregate create this kind of crazy city.
The last time I arrived, I went into a bus on the airport that just went past hotels. So I had the experience.
So now the new poster child for banality and horrid urban design is Liberty Village, where they took this idea, and going back to what you talked about with your project, Gary, that Toronto loves this connection. All people love this connection with history and the layering of history and this juxtaposition of new buildings and old buildings. And that's what gives life and energy. In connection to the city, there's this amazing novel that if you're really interested in Toronto, you should read, called Consolation, written by Michael Redhill. And he talks about this it talks about Toronto in 1840 and the immigrants from England primarily coming here and saying, my God, how did we land here? And what is this horrible place with muddy streets and lack of, you know, sophistication and so forth, and then present-day Toronto, and it weaves a narrative between two families from then and now, and tries to explain this city, and it is really amazing, and that is what we are grappling with now, is the juxtaposition of this idea of Victorian city, and now this idea of Manhattan, and how do we kind of interlace and weave this that is specific to the city, and it will be very interesting, and I sound negative, and I didn't come from the city. I didn't like Toronto, but in the last 3 or 4 years, I've become to think that this has the kind of nascent position of becoming an interesting place because of the overlay of density.
Natalie, I think we're going to give you the last word, then we need to wrap this up because there's a reception waiting for us very nearby, I'm told.
Okay, what I just wanted to say is that we've been talking about responsibility of the city, of developers, but I also noticed that in this changing dialogue between government and the private sector, designers can play a very interesting role, because as we maybe sometimes have this tendency to say, oh, well, what the architect says becomes less and less interesting and important, and our role is shrinking. But I'm actually noticing that this is exactly the point where you can sort of use your knowledge and experience and grab a position and start a conversation and help to think of solutions by design sometimes to solve these issues, because I believe a lot of these things can also start by making other designs and better designs and being aware of the conditions you are working in. And when we just simply accept all the conditions we are put in and endlessly multiply them, indeed nothing will ever happen. So I think I strongly believe in this type of discussions and a growing awareness. Also discussions with the public, but also explaining to students that there is not one solution, that over time design solution might wear out or are simply not growing up against the sort of tides of developments that you have to deal with. Now, I'm not saying design is the solution for everything, but through design you can sometimes start conversations with clients, with cities, and that is also how I try to show in my lecture, actually, how it's all result also of dialogues by design, you could say, and maybe some of the things we did will work, and maybe some of the things we did will fail, but and there's not always one typical solution, that is something I'd like to stress here, especially for this audience here at the Ryerson audience, the architecture school.
Well, on that hopeful note, I'd like to thank you, Natalie, and thank all of the panelists for contributing to this discussion. Thank you. Thank you.